Welcome back to more Warhammer lore. In this video, we will be delving into the Lizardmen of Lustria and also the Southlands, specifically their society, religion, and culture. Now, I will be assuming you have seen my video on the Great Old Ones and have knowledge of who and what they are, and so if you haven't, I will have a link in the description to my previous video for you to watch so that you are not completely lost, as much of the Lizardmen lore is deeply rooted in the Old Ones and their worship and the great plan they left behind. Now, as a disclaimer, I am basing most of this video off of the recent army books and various novels of the Warhammer world. I am saying this because Lizardmen have gone through several different evolutions throughout the history of Warhammer Fantasy, and so some of you may know a different version of their history and lore, but I will do my best to keep it to the current lore and maybe add a few of my own opinions to bridge the gap of when the lore simply fails, as the Lizardmen, much like the Old Ones, are supposed to be a mysterious ancient race, and so the lore is thin in some places. Well, now that that PR statement is over, let's get into the lore proper. The Lizardmen, sometimes known as the Cold Ones or the Children of the Gods, are an ancient, savage race of cold-blooded reptiles that are at one time the first and oldest civilization within the Warhammer world. Long before the rise of men, elf, or dwarf, the Empire of the Lizardmen ruled supreme. Alien, enigmatic, and without mercy, Lizardmen were there when it all began, and they will be there when the world draws its last dying breath, never tiring nor relenting till order is finally restored to this uncaring, chaotic world. Such is what they were made to do, for they are the ancient servants of the Old Ones, the one true protectors of this very world. Once in a long and forgotten age, the Lizardmen ruled over all, dominating this ancient world during an age of primeval monsters. Although the realm is now partly in ruins and overgrown, they seek once more to rise up and reclaim that which they have lost many millennia ago. While the task at hand remains near impossible, the Empire of the Lizardmen still fights on, unleashing their cold-blooded savagery upon any who would stand in their way of their sacred mission. From the lust jungles they come, beneath totems of gold, the Lizardmen march to war, the ground trembling from the approach of their large and mighty reptilian armies. They go to battle for reasons indecipherable to others, an ancient plan known only to themselves. None can ever understand their motives nor their ceaseless drive, for none truly understand that they are the rightful inheritors of this world, and it is their sacred, if inscrutable, duty to restore order across this planet. If this means the wholesale eradication of the lesser upstart races outside of the Great Plan, then the Lizardmen Empire shall enact this world-spanning genocide once more. Now, before we get into the politics or really anything else, we should definitely discuss what exactly a Lizardman is. The term Lizardman is the name used by many outsiders to represent all of the intelligent, cold-blooded denizens of the jungle continent of Lustria. The Lizardmen as a whole are a race of large, bipedal reptile and amphibian hybrids that live almost exclusively within the warm tropical climates and jungle environments. Though many often find little distinction between each of the individual species that make up their civilization, the Lizardmen race is not a single race, but rather consists of a collection of vastly different species. Though they may be genetically related to other reptiles that inhabit the continent of Lustria, only the Slan, Saurus, Skinks, and Croxagores are considered an actual part of the core Lizardmen race. The mystical Slan appear almost toad-like, with bloated, sluggish bodies that contain an almost alien intellect. Large, unearthly creatures, the Slan are quite unlike anything else seen within the Warhammer world. Their heads are large to match their mighty intellect held within, and their eyes are bulbous and all-seeing. They can live for thousands of years, and their bodies become more bloated with the passing centuries. Now, the Slan are in fact the leaders of the Lizardmen now that the Old Ones are gone, but they are by no means perfect. In fact, their intelligence is so advanced that they seem to be able to predict the future by use of what they refer to as the Great Math, a series of equations utilizing star patterns, the geomantic web, and an unsettling ability to predict the actions of the lesser races. I'm sure that the Slan were designed in this way so that they could communicate with the Old Ones, as the original spawning of Slan were the emissaries of these celestial beings and the only mortals that could stand the presence without dying or going insane. This vast intelligence also allows the Slan to utilize magic in a way that is far beyond the reach of most of the lesser races. In fact, Even the youngest of Slann would be a match for the most powerful spellcaster of the elves, and probably even the Lords of Change, the greater demons of Tzeentch. However, this vast intelligence comes with a drawback, in that they don't appear to understand the actions of the lesser races, as they are completely devoid of emotion, more akin to a cold, calculating, sentient machine than a living being. In fact, that is a thing you will be seeing often when we speak about the Lizardmen in general. The Slann are essentially immortal, if they do not die of old age, is what I mean. Of course they can be killed, but they are so immensely powerful that their spirits can be bound into a sort of mummy of their deceased corpse, from which they can actually perform magic and some of the activities they did while they were still alive. Now, because they essentially cannot die of old age, and this may in fact be a more reptilian quality, they spend literally centuries in meditation, mulling over the sacred plaques left behind by the old ones and trying to determine the will of the great plan that all Slann are attempting to decipher, and often argue about the course for their people. But we are getting a little ahead of ourselves now, so let's move on to the next tier of the Lizardmen species. The powerful Saurus are like large bipedal crocodiles whose entire body seems geared towards combat and warfare. They stand larger than a man, with bony crests protecting their heads and neck, and tough scales that run down their backs, arms, and spines. Even unarmored, Saurus are perfectly capable of slaying their enemies, for their tails and limbs are equipped with all manner of naturally hard spurs and talons, and their jaws are powerful enough to crush bone. Now, if the Slann are the supreme rulers, wizards, and I would probably relate them closer to a clergy class, if anything, the Saurus are simply the warriors and guards of the Lizardmen Empire. They are not very intelligent whatsoever, seeing as they were not created with intelligence in mind. The Slann are the ones who give them direction, and they simply follow orders without any question. In fact, much like the Slann, Saurus are cold, emotionless beings of hulking muscle and ferocity who simply live to serve the Slann and the Great Plan. Now, I'm not saying that they are stupid. I'm simply saying that they have a different kind of intelligence. Where the Slann control magic and predict the future, the Saurus, once they are spawned, have an innate knowledge of battle. They are born with the ability to use their weapons proficiently, and no Lizardman is trained in the way the lesser races are trained for battle. They simply know how to fight and grasp the basics of tactics and battlefield strategy. Now, Saurus, much like the Slann, appear to be immortal in that they cannot die of old age. Hell, at this point, Krokgar is several thousand years old, as well as his mount. And the way Saurus move up through the ranks is by age and possible spawning. I'll be getting into spawnings later on in the video, but suffice to say that sometimes there are particular spawnings that will birth leaders for the Saurus instead of just warriors, whom are more proficient in every way, especially when it comes to commanding their troops. Also, as I was saying, all Saurus are born with innate combat skills, but with age comes battle, and every time a Saurus participates in a battle and lives, they gain more combat experience and ultimately become more efficient warriors, in the same way veteran soldiers perform in other armies. The only difference is that the Saurus don't get old and die, and therefore theoretically can gain unlimited experience, producing some of the greatest fighters to have ever existed in the Warhammer world. Now, I will be getting into the individual units in my military Lizardmen video, so stay tuned for that one. But for now, let's move on to the Skinks, which are small, agile, and intelligent creatures that evolved from the amphibious animals that lived in the swamps of Lustria many millennia ago. The Skinks have the greatest variation in comparison to the other Lizardmen species, but all are universally small, skittish, stealthy, and swift. This makes them exceptionally good hunters, stalking through dense jungles and killing any warm-blooded creatures that would dare to venture into their world. The Skinks have a natural affinity with water and can swim swiftly through dark jungle swamps and rivers. Now, the Skinks are nearly the lowest class of Lizardmen in a way, but at the same time they aren't. They appear to be much more intelligent than Saurus, though nowhere near that of a Slann, and they make up the bulk of the skirmishers in battle and also tend to the day-to-day activities of running the Lizardmen Empire. The Skinks are the artisans, they are the blacksmiths, they are the hunters, they are the janitors, and they are whatever the Slann needs them to be. They fill every role that the Saurus and one more species do not. In fact, they even have their own hierarchy unto themselves, with skink chiefs leading forces into battle, usually riding a pterodon or some other great beast the skinks have learned to tame over the centuries. They also have the ability to use magic, as the skink priests are excellent mages and would be the equivalent to your average human mage, and are even capable of performing awe-inspiring feats of magic with the aid of the Slayer, who can cast through them as a conduit or through the infamous Sotek. Now, I will not be going into too much detail on Sotek in this particular video, but I will be delving into this topic in its own video, so keep an eye out for that. Oh, and as kind of I just mentioned, they are also the ones responsible for domesticating and taking care of the many monstrous creatures that are found in the Lustrian jungle. The last of the Lizardmen species is the hulking Croxagore, which are the largest of the Lizardmen race. They are essentially giant cousins of the Saurus, bred for their brute strength and power. They are large, powerful creatures, yet their intellect and speech capabilities are far more limited than that of the Saurus. They are terribly strong, able to bear enormous loads, and they are encased with an almost stone-hard scale of powerful reptilian armor. The Croxagores are the last and largest of the Lizardmen species. They're probably close to the size of a troll or ogre, with the thinking capacity even less than that of a Saurus warrior. The primary function of the Croxagores are heavy lifters of the Lizardmen race, utilized by the skinks, much in the same way that they domesticate the wild animals to build the large temple cities for the Fourth Islan, by hefting the massive, solid pieces of stone wherever the skinks instruct them to place it. In addition to their day-to-day use, they are often used in battle as line breakers, though they must be accompanied by skinks to give them direction, and their weapons need to be chained to their wrist, because otherwise, through experience, the skinks have learned that the great beast will simply discard them and run into the enemy with their tooth and claws, which is probably effective, but a one-ton brawn cudgel is much more effective. If a skink is not directing a Croxagore to do anything, they will simply stand there and just mull around with not knowing what to do, just being generally confused, and ultimately they need direction to function. One more interesting note about Lizardmen biology, or possibly a racial trait, is that they are the only race in all of Warhammer that is completely immune to Chaos influence. In fact, you could say that they are the complete opposite of that. They are, in fact, the furthest you can get from that as a society. There has not been, to my knowledge, a single Lizardman, not a single one, that has succumbed to the call of the Dark Gods, and that definitely says something about them as a whole, as there is a Lizardman hero that spent, I want to say, 100 years in the actual realms of Chaos and came back, and he is not tainted in any way. They are methodical and brutal in their execution, which perhaps is why they can't be influenced, as they appear to not have the necessary emotions that the Dark Gods tend to exploit in their followers. Now, from a geographical standpoint, you can find the Lizardmen in the jungles of Lustria, where they thrive as well, oddly enough, in the jungles of the Southlands, which would be the equivalent of Africa. Now, this does get a little convoluted, and the lore is at odds with itself on how this happened. You see, all the Lizardmen were originally in Lustria, and you are kind of led to believe that the Southlands were once connected to Lustria, and some cataclysmic event, like the collapse of the warp gates at the poles, literally shifted the continents of the Warhammer world, separating the Lizardmen of the now Southlands from their Lustrian cousins. I am not necessarily believe that completely, as this topic and the lore is all over the place. There is no way of knowing how quickly Chaos spread after this collapse, or what impact it had on the topography of the world. I would like to believe that this was simply a colony that was cut off after the collapse, but as I said, it is a matter of interpretation, since at the same time, Ulthuan was somehow raised from the depths, but from my knowledge, they were created while the Old Ones were still present. They were still giving direction to uplift the elves, and so it wouldn't make a lot of sense if the continents were connected, because Lustria wouldn't have existed, because it was raised out of the ocean. So, not Ulthuan was raised out of the ocean, not Lustria. And so it just wouldn't make a lot of sense for it to happen at the same time, and it just gets very confusing. I prefer to believe it as a colony that was cut off, just because it makes more sense in my mind and how it all happened, but you're more than welcome to believe what you want. Now, the jungles of Lustria themselves have in fact been engineered by the Lizardmen to be hostile towards outsiders. This is very interesting. They get into genetic manipulation, obviously. This happened shortly after the collapse, when the forces of Chaos primarily focused on stomping out the children of the Old Ones, and the Lizardmen used every advantage they had to thwart this advance, including creating the treacherous bogs, insects, man-eating plants, and animals of the jungle to hinder enemy movement. Now, the collapse is a very interesting topic, and one that is very in-depth and vast, and maybe one day, if there's enough interest, I might do a video on it, but for now we will be kind of skimming over it. I covered a little bit of it, well, a lot of it actually, in my Old Ones video, so if you watch that, you will kind of get a idea of what I'm talking about. Now, let's move on to the Lizardmen reproductive cycle, as it actually is a very interesting and unique trait of their species. The Lizardmen's core species, such as the Slan, Sauras, Skinks, and Croxagores, are not born from eggs, like their feral reptilian cousins, but are birthed from special pools and ponds located within sacred regions of the jungle. This birthing of a new generation of Lizardmen are called spawnings. Every temple city has its own sacred ponds and expanses of marsh where the spawning events occur. Skinks and Croxagores tend to spawn in the same ponds and swamps open to the sky, where Sauras and certain other Croxagores are usually spawned in dank subterranean caverns. Pyramid temples are frequently built over the top of the entrances to such caverns, and outlined swamps are sometimes made into rectangular ponds encircled by stone. Now, due to their amphibious origins, some days after the spawning event begins, little tadpoles emerge out of the water, growing in numbers and size at an extremely accelerated rate, feeding on the enormous numbers of tropical insects that hover above such waters. When the Lizardmen are fully developed, they emerge onto dry land in enormous numbers at the exact same time. The interval between spawnings can be very long, and usually spawning will not occur in the same pond within the lifetime of the last generation that was born there. Thus, each city is surrounded with multiple spawning pools, which spawn at different times of the year. Each spawning is linked to astrological cycles, and will always begin at certain conjunctions of the stars and planets. Since each generation emerged from different ponds at different intervals in time, there are always several dozen Lizardmen of the same age and origins living within tightly knit groups within their home city. Being of the same spawning, different A groups will also have varying degrees of features which are unique to that particular spawning, such as different skin tones, unique markings, a calm and calculated attitude towards administrative duties, or perhaps a more fierce and warlike attitude. These large groups of Lizardmen are given a single directive or purpose upon their birth, such as either being formed into cohorts or tribal warriors, or becoming the artisans and workers for their respective temple cities. The spawnings that only birth a single individual usually mean that this particular Lizardman is meant to be a leader amongst their kind. Due to the timing of spawnings, the mage priests have carefully records which detail the time when a new spawning will occur. But not all are recorded, and some spawnings will appear to happen at completely random intervals in time. This was also the case with the special skinks of Sotek, that were relatively immune to the plagues of the clan pestilence, and fairly ferocious for skinks, whom were spawned with bright red crests and coloring in conjunction with their patron deity. But once again, we will be covering Sotek and a great deal of Lizardmen history in a future video. The society of the Lizardmen is highly sophisticated and ancient beyond reckoning. It was they who first became the world's first true civilization, erecting their cities of ancient stone long before the rise of men, elf, or dwarf. It was they who once ruled the world as the most dominant civilization, eradicating whole species of undesirables from the face of the earth, and writing down ancient mathematics and astronomy upon chiseled tablets of stone, fallen before mortals even learned how to write. While many other civilizations have risen and fallen over the long millennia, it is the Lizardmen who have truly endured throughout all the ages, having been there from the birth of creation unto its final lasting days. Even throughout all this time, Lizardmen society has remained unchanged for millennia, being focused around a highly structured and strictly enforced caste system. The caste system was built and formed by the orders of the Old Ones, whom themselves created each of the separate Lizardmen species to fulfill a certain role in their society. Each and every core species is born into one of these castes. The Lizardmen are taught, and perhaps bred, to be fanatically loyal to their respective duties, offering little room for any sense of individuality or freedom of thought amongst their kind. Within the system, each caste is composed strictly of one or two of the core species meant to fulfill an extremely important part of Lizardmen society as dictated by the Old One's instructions, either as workers, warriors, or rulers. As far as how their society functions, this is a good synopsis as I could come up with. There are a relatively united people, there is no outright civil war, and even the varying opinions of the slan of each temple city all agree that they should be serving the great plan. They just all need to get on the same page as to do what exactly. Now, which that does lead me into my next topic, Lizardmen religion. The Lizardmen all revere the Old Ones as almighty deities, the ancient and long forgotten creators of this very world. Many long bloody millennia have passed since the collapse of the Polar Gates and the departure of the Old Ones. No living slan mage priest remains to speak of them, and so they passed from memory into legend. Ever since then, the enigmatic Old Ones have come to be regarded not as benevolent rulers of an order spanning the universe and the dimensions, but now as a distant, long-lost pantheon of hungry gods. With no first-hand knowledge of the Old Ones, and with their records scattered and incomplete since the Great Catastrophe, the Lizardmen have but a fragmented picture of their creators. The sacred plaques are replete with oblique and obscure references to various Old Ones and their deeds, and from these the Lizardmen have come to associate specific traits with individual Old Ones. Tlanxla, for example, is an Old One described in many glyphs as the embodiment of the warlike nature of the Lizardmen, and a pair of matching glyphs, sequence in Hexwaddle and Itza, makes reference to him riding to war in an almighty sky chariot. Quittle is spoken of in sacred plaques of Hexwaddle as the protector of the true way. Hexwaddle, the Old One after which the temple city is named, is described in every sequence that mentions him as the chooser of those destined for greatness. As the Lizardmen have come into conflict with more and more races, these Old Ones associated with the martial aspect of Lizardmen's nature have come to the forefront. These sacred plaques are the greatest controversy, as there are many and sometimes they have subtle variations depending on which temple city you are reading them at. For instance, one plaque might say that the Lizardmen are forbidden from leaving the jungles of Lustria, while another might call for the purging of chaos in all its forms across the world. Which is why the slan have been so divided on this topic, as they are trying to decipher what the Old Ones intended for them to do when given contrasting orders. Any other race would have simply picked a direction and started down one path, but this is the folly of the all-knowing slan, as they have to contemplate and calculate every single action before taking any. Worship of the Old Ones is a highly ritualistic affair, but its exact form depends on the deity in question and the nature of the worshipper who conducts it. The slan mage priest, for example, presides over all manner of ceremonies that occur within his domain, but yet he remains impassive throughout the entire experience. A slan may be carried to a high altar to make the ceremony an official event, yet he would remain in his meditation trance the entire time, completely unaware or uncaring of the ceremony itself. As such, it is the skink priests that actually carry out the many and varied observances, abasements, and rites associated with each of the Old Ones. The Saurs too pay homage to the lost gods, though these simple-minded creatures do it in their own way, a simple way. They may heap the bodies of fallen enemies before a totem to the warrior defender Quetzal, for example, or swallow whole the still-beating heart of a vanquished warrior in honor of Tizgatil, I butchered that, I'm sorry guys. He who grants strength to a warrior's arm. Even the near mindless Croxagores make observances to the gods of the Lizardmen. This worship comes from a resounding, low rumbling chant as the sun rises. Perhaps once, before the Great Catastrophe, the Lizardmen communicated directly to their masters or had no need to do this at all, since all their needs were already predicted, and met. Long after their departure, however, the Lizardmen go to ever great lengths to enact the will of the gods. Of course, worship has changed drastically since the rise of Sotek, but once again, we will be visiting that topic in a later video, so be on the lookout for that. Now, as far as an economy is concerned, the Lizardmen don't have one. Every member of their society performs their duties simply because they have to. They don't do it for money or recognition. They simply do as they're told and what they have been bred for, which is why they are often at odds with other races, as the most common form of building material outside of stone in the Lizardmen Empire is gold. Their cities are literally made out of gold, which is why plundering vacant and sometimes not so vacant Lizardmen temple cities has become a regular occurrence for many of the lesser races. As you can imagine, when most races come to face to face with Lizardmen, they probably just see a form of semi-intelligent monster, and that is kind of true, but they are in fact a quite old and powerful society. Now, as far as trade is concerned, it does not exist. From what I have extrapolated, there may have been some kind of trade thousands of years ago between the Lizardmen of the Southlands and that of the ancient kingdom of Khemri, which some of you may know now as the Lands of the Tomb Kings. You see, long before it was a land of the undead, it was a thriving, almost Egyptian kingdom of men, and the city of Ryestra would even bring salamanders and other various typical Lizardmen beasts to war with them. This may also account for the way in which Khemri was able to build their great pyramids and got the idea to embalm their dead from their experiences with the Lizardmen. Now, I'm not saying that they had a relationship with Khemri as far as trade or even allies. I'm simply saying that they obviously had some kind of influence on the kingdom and far more of an interaction than they have had with any of the other recent races in memory. I did forget to mention about the Estalian merchant, whom in fact attempted a diplomatic trade agreement, once again with the Lizardmen of the Southlands. He in fact did manage to actually get an audience with the Slan of the local temple city, with a skink translating for him, of course. He was attempting to establish an overland trade route to the east with Cathay, Inde, Nippon, which would bypass the need to sail around the Southlands, risking your crew to extortion from the High Elves, capture by the Dark Elves, and piracy from everyone else in between. Of course, they didn't go for it, but the simple fact that he even got an audience does show that the Lizardmen of the Southlands, for some reason, tend to be more progressive than their Lustrian cousins. The Lizardmen language, known as Saurian, is a primeval reptilian tongue. It is almost unpronounceable for any race other than the Lizardmen to speak, due in part because it contains so many unique sounds that can't be spoken in other tongues. Only a Lizardman can voice these or interpret them as words or sentences. The Lizardman's written language is much more understandable. Kind of. Mainly being composed upon glyphs chiseled into bare stone or gold, it is doubtful whether the Saurian tongue was spoken by the Old Ones, as they probably communicated with the Slan by means of telepathy, as the Slan tend to communicate with their subjects. As such, many scholars believe that the Saurian language is one unique to the Lizardmen race. Now, similar to the Old One video I did, a lot of this information is being relayed via the scholars of the Empire and some of the High Elf scholars as well. So take some of this information with a grain of salt. But I think I have done my best in giving you all a decent grasp of the Lizardmen and what makes them special and unique as a race. That is going to be all I have for today, guys. There is more coming, but feel free to ask questions down in the comment section if I missed anything drastic. I will put it in the next video, which will be coming soon. Make sure to like and subscribe for any future content that I have coming out. It really does help out the channel and gets these videos and the information out to as many people as want to hear it. I would like to say thank you to all my new subscribers, and of course the same to my loyal followers. I vastly appreciate it, and it's what keeps me coming back making these lore videos. Now, with that being said, I have been Jumbo Thick. Thank you for watching, and I hope you learned something, and I look forward to seeing you in the next video. Have a good day.